So, in this video, we're going to simply consider a much discredited theory of seeing from which we can still learn. I'm referring to the extramissive theory of vision, which is often, perhaps poorly understood, as the idea that rays come out of the eyes to strike an object and that this is how we come to know an object. Now, central to this debate is going to be the role of the image on the retina. We'll get to it in just a minute, but note, first of all, that the image on the retina is perhaps not so special. Images are peculiar things. I'm not sure they are things. But if you get down on your knees and you examine a dewdrop, you'll find, typically, within that, an image projected onto the surface of the sphere. This is how light works, given appropriate refractive conditions, an observer can see an image projected onto many, many surfaces. Dewdrops are also not so special in this regard. If you look at the light going through the leaves of a tree on a sunny day, you'll see a dappling effect. And if you were to crawl up and climb up into the branches, you would find hundreds, thousands, millions of brief occasions in which the light is filtered through a pinhole and then captured by a surface. That is to say, there would be millions of tiny images which appear and disappear on the leaves. And this is what we see as dappling. Now, those images have no particular ontological seriousness about them. They go unobserved. They can only be understood as images, really, if we take the opportunity to view them as images. And when light goes through a peephole and there is a suitably receptive surface, or when light is bent in the right way, as in a dewdrop, an image is formed. This gave rise to the technology of the camera obscura once upon a time. Here you can see an interior, and there's an illuminated object on the exterior, and you can see that the light rays bouncing off the exterior object collect at a point, a pinhole point, because of the pinhole. Then when they pass through this, they reproduce an image upside down on the wall of the interior. This interior is very abstract. Camera obscuras can be built in various ways with various means of viewing them. One of the most wholehearted approaches, perhaps, is to step inside the thing so that you can view the image. There are magnificent examples of this around. Now, the camera obscura as a technology came into being around the same time, and not coincidentally so, as the development of techniques of linear perspective in painting, a point we'll return to. Before now, we'll simply note that the inverted image on the back of the eyeball is an example of a phenomenon which is very widespread, which can be technologized and turned to various purposes. It was Johannes Kepler, the same guy who gave us the elliptical orbits of the planet, who first noted the inverted image on the eyeball and realized its structural analogy to a camera obscura. This image seems to have stuck with us since. Notice, however, that this goes no further than the retina. In contemporary imagistic theories of vision, however, the image is given a kind of an afterlife beyond the retina. So examples like this are commonplace in textbooks, in which the manner in which an image is projected on the retina is fairly clear, but notice here the image is further projected into the brain in some way, into what's called visual cortex. And so we get this view which has taken over our accounts of seeing as they are contracted to vision, with this kind of weird interiority and exteriority opposed to each other. So the butterfly is part of an external world, but the, well, it depends what seeing a butterfly is. The perception of the butterfly is presumed to correspond to some brain activity, which is interior to the viewing subject. This goes a long way beyond Kepler's observation that the eyeball functions as a camera obscura and accords a persistence to the image despite the complications of nerves and brains, none of which clearly transmit images at all. Underlying the appeal of such approaches is a form of constructive sensory epistemology, which we have acquired over hundreds of years, and for which experimental evidence can be sought. Some of the most compelling experimental evidence, and most influential in this line, has been provided by the Nobel Prize-winning work of Hubel and Wiesel, who worked with anesthetized cats using a form of recording from individual brain cells that was very novel at the time, but which required that the cat be absolutely passive. The cat be anesthetized, because any movement would destroy the electrode that was recording what was going on at the brain cell. These anesthetized cats had their eyes propped open, much like Alex in the finals in the second half of Clockwork Orange. And then various optical patterns are projected onto a board or screen in front, and co-variation with the electrode, the activity measured by the electrode and visual cortex is recorded. And you can do this in primary visual cortex, and you can peer further into the brain. As we do so, what was uncovered was a picture that fitted an older view of the construction of mental representations from sensory primitives. This is a kind of epistemology developed in the wake of Descartes, Locke, Kant, Hume, but which was wanting flesh, as it were. When this experiment, or this series of experiments was performed, it was found that cells closer to the retina, that is those in the first way station, the primary visual cortex, seemed to respond to properties that made sense to the scientists in terms of the patterns of light they were showing. So if you show high contrast patterns, vertical bars, moving bars, there was a correspondence between the structure of the stimulus and the response registered at the electrode. Moving further into the brain, the relationship or covariation, shall we say, between what was recordable at an electrode and what was presented on the screen became more obscure. Increasingly, what was going on at the electrode seemed to have something more to do with a meaningful interpretation of what was presented rather than its simple characterization as patterns of black and white. Now, this was developed in the language of cognitive psychology, developed using a form of information theory derived from grotesquely transcending that of Claude Shannon. And it gave rise, among other things, to the dual stream theory of Milner and Goodale, in which the brain is understood as an information processor, and recordings taken deeper in the brain are understood as accessing, as it were, the brain's local representation of what was seen on the outside. This is the basic structure of the neuroscientific construction of an imagistic view of seeing contracted to vision. It is intromissive, and it is laudably announced as an intromissive theory, and extramissive theories are proclaimed heresy, not least because they seem somewhat improbable. Indeed, I'm going to just use the improbability of a basilisk equipped with laser eyes to illustrate the unlikelihood of any theory gaining ground which involves lasers or similar light beams coming out of the eye. But that's not really what extramissive theory of vision is about. It's about the relationship between the viewer and the thing viewed. Here's an older illustration which purports to show or to explain extramissive vision. You can see rays coming out of the eyes and they're striking the object. Let's just live with the fact that there's a dragon in the sky. For our purposes, that's okay. And there was great debate then about whether such a theory had any merit. Plato notoriously was for it, and Aristotle was against it. So we have one of those classic debates that go a long, long way back. Galen, working in the second century of the Common Era, subscribed to an extramissive theory of vision because his understanding of the brain and the nervous system required that there be some form of conduction, which we today wouldn't countenance. But his work formed the basis for the anatomy and physiology of the eye for 1500 years, and hence most of the work done in among the Arabs in subsequent centuries subscribed more or less to an extramissive theory of vision, although not everyone. Ibn Sina regarded the eyes as mirrors rather than as camera obscura, as projecting images. Both Newton and Locke themselves had held some version of an extramissive theory. But it was with Kepler that we made this direct link to the technology of the camera obscura and the image on the back of the retina. The image, the notion of extramission hasn't gone away. A recent philosopher of cognitive science, Max Velmans, argues for something like a form of extramissive projection to account for the apparent exteriority of the phenomenal world, what we call our viewing of an external world. Why should such an unlikely theory still kind of interest us? Well, the answer is that as improbable and absolutely improbable as most simplistic accounts of extramissive viewing are, vision, intromissive theories don't seem to be on any more secure ground. The question is not, was it a choice between images going in or rays coming out? The answer is all our understanding of eyes and of vision and of seeing are beholden to the properties of the geometry of light. If we return to that previous slide, you'll notice that the lines drawn from the eyes to the dragon can equally well be interpreted as lines going from the dragon to the eyes. That is, a diagram required for the physical support of seeing does not differentiate between an intromissive and an extramissive theory of vision. Light moves in straight lines, bounces in certain ways, refracts in certain ways. The popularity of the view of intromission derives not from geometry of light or from careful study of anatomy and physiology, but from beliefs about the brain, beliefs about mental representation, and odd beliefs about images. This is why I'm calling this the imagistic theory. I'm going to wrap up here and just say that the reason I turn to extramission is to show that the more popular view of intromission is no more secure than extramission as a basis for vision. It assumes an awful lot that is entirely optional. To make sense of an intromissive theory requires certain assumptions about brains, etc. Now, while they are widespread, are far less than secure. Relational theories of vision, which we'll bounce off occasionally, do not appeal to images at all, or to the brain as a locus of consciousness, or to the vexing problems of images and representation. But they're coming at the question of seeing in a very different way that we'll perhaps address. For now, this first video is simply to unsettle the notion that we know what's going on in seeing, that we have a theory of it, and that the idea is that images are being projected into the brain, a kind of a fairy story that we tell school children. We leave it now, but in the next video we're going to turn to the conventional practice within scientific orthodoxy of freezing the subject in order to study vision, and we'll come back to the notion of the fixation cross.